Gentlemen, welcome to the 33rd public lecture by Bengal Institute. This lecture today is the part of the ongoing academic program that we just finished. It was learning from Aga Khan Award for Architecture. We had a brilliant session with very enthusiastic participation, and for the first time, Bengal Institute's academic program happened here in Dhanmundi neighborhood. So we are not doing it in Khilkhet anymore. We have come near to you. So I think it's an important reason for everybody to apply more and more for our academic program. And the upcoming one you might have seen on Facebook and our website is about space. Space is society, that's what we are calling it. How different type of spaces around us, how we navigate it, how we understand it from different perspective, through social perspective and gender and equality and political and everything. So it will be a mixture of very different diverse group of faculties who we are going to announce very soon, maybe today or tomorrow. Some of the names I can give you: Kirsten Heckenbrock, Cassia Paproki. She is one of the important writers of today around the climate of this region. One of the greatest contemporary architecture photographer, Cemal Emden from Istanbul, is coming. Our favorite Professor Shamsul Waris will be there. And human rights activist Khushi Kobir, environmental lawyer Sayed Rezwana Hassan, Dhali Al Mamun, and Salahuddin Ahmed. These people will be taking an 8 days long program. I mean, 8 days of activities, but it will be on 2 weeks long program about this spaces society. Please apply. It is already up for application. Everybody should jump in. Without taking much time, I would now like to invite Professor Kazi Khalid Ashraf to introduce our speaker today.
Okay, সবাইকে স্বাগত আজকে এই সন্ধ্যায় তো আমি ইংরেজিতে বলি to welcome our good friend and visitor from Morocco, Hassan Radoine, visiting us all the way from Morocco. Hassan is an architect, urban scientist, academic and scholar. He has been involved in major urban and building restoration projects in Marrakesh, Morocco. He has taught in the UAE, the US, the UK, and after a long journey of learning and teaching and experiencing places all across the globe, he returned to Morocco to teach. He currently heads the King Mohammed VI Polytechnic in Marrakesh, where he is involved in a very transformative education in architecture. And perhaps we'll talk about that a little bit, I'm not sure. And as a scholar, he writes. His book, Architecture in the Middle East, which is the basis of today's presentation, has been very widely received and well received across the globe. And perhaps you might want to check that book for your understanding. He has been involved with the Aga Khan Award for Architecture for many years in various capacities, especially as a technical reviewer for many projects, and some of which have won the award. But all this sounds like a bio, which I'm not going to do, and I did a little bit, but if you want to read up more on him, you'll find that on our website and the Facebook pages. What I would like to particularly emphasize is that Hassan is a most reflective architect and human being, a person you'd like to have as a friend And I think I have that, and some of us here in Dhaka have that. It's a great pleasure and an honor to have someone like that in our midst. Hassan is critical, precise, sharp, and inspiring. All those things you need in a friend. I believe with him that what our cultures need are not architectures of spectacular presence or flamboyance, and we see a lot of that, and we get amazed by those. But rather, we need a practice of thoughtfulness, depth, and deliberateness in what we want to pursue. We want a way out of our current mess. And some people are willing to work on those areas and try to show how to get out of that mess. Hassan embodies those qualities. Hassan would also like to think from the conversations we have with him, and I'm not making this up, that we at Bengal Institute are pursuing those qualities too. More important than architecture that visually thrills us, and often visually stunning things will thrill us. But more than that, we need an architecture of deep resonance. The word resonance comes from music. So it's a musical term, so there's a musical attunement, a musical relationship with what? So resonant, an architecture of resonance, not resistance, which is another thing. An architecture of resonance, resonant with the lyrics of the landscape, with the pulse of the people, and the hymns of history. So that's the kind of architecture we think of when you take on a reflective mode. Here in Bangladesh, we often think that Morocco is a very far-off place. Although we travel, bypass Morocco and go to the United States or Canada or other places, but we think Morocco is really far away. But we think Morocco it's far away in a kind of mental way, not so much in a physical way. Because it's a fabulous land of unbelievable cities, city landscapes, incredible buildings, the image of courtyards and gardens, you know, all those things that we have seen in images thrill us and beckon us there. So, and some of us who are lucky to be there, we know that those are all true. But Morocco is also far closer to Bangladesh than one imagines. We share, architecturally speaking, the same fractures and confusions and debates and diversions and false destinations. You know, we take on a destination, we are not sure. Sometimes we are sure, but still we pursue that destination because we know we're not brave enough to get out of that path. But also we share with Morocco a richness of possibilities in traces of historical wealth. So there are possibilities that history and the landscape offer to us, which we bypass to go on to that false path. And how to go about reaching those possibilities, that can only come through a reflective practice. So you know, what I emphasize is reflective practice. So in our shared journey, Morocco and Bangladesh, Hassan and us, in our shared journey for an architecture of meaningfulness, cities of well-being and reflective positions, I think I can claim Hassan and I are comrades, brothers and friends. Hassan.
Wow, what to say after Kazi? He's always nailing the points. First of all, I'm happy and delighted to be among you today. And I think it is a privilege to be here and, of course, to be introduced by my dear colleague and friend, Kazi. And, of course, Kazi Ashraf Khalid, but he's known in Japan by the name Kazi. And it is actually also an honor to be here in Bangladesh and especially Dhaka. I heard a lot about Bangladesh, but I've never been here. I've been all over the planet, and it's quite an interesting place. Very, very interesting place and very inspiring landscape and very kind people. Thank you for your warm reception. And I would like also to thank the global the Bengal Institute for Architecture, Landscapes and Settlements, and of course for inviting me to do series of lectures, and this is the public one here. And of course I should not forget to thank the Aga Khan Award, with which I am involved as a technical reviewer to do a lot of evaluations on the ground for so many nominated projects for the last 8 years, almost maybe now 3 cycles. And of course I'd like to thank in person Farouk Darakhshani, the director of the Aga Khan Award in Geneva. So let me start. I think all what Kazi has already underlined is true. I think we are in developing countries, and we are not developing just in the new era, but we are among those ancient civilizations and among places they have strong memory and places that they did have architecture. Please bear with me. We are not a places they have nothing. There are these places, they are rooted, and I can see this beautiful country and how much amazing cultural antecedents they are on the ground. And Morocco is similar. And I will prove to you through this presentation that how can we explore the genius of places. As Kazi said, architecture is not a mere exercise of playing with forms. Architecture is not an aesthetic play for amusement only. Architecture is not just a croquis that will make and change the lives of people. Architecture is deeper than that. And this is why I congratulate our colleagues, archaeologists, when they will unravel the truth of a site somewhere. They go and they find maybe minimum fragments. From each fragment is meaningful, and how they can reconstruct the meaning of a whole culture from a couple of fragments. Do our architecture today, in 2080, maybe 3000, if an archaeologist will come and they unravel these empty boxes of concrete, and what they mean, maybe they may not find anything. Maybe I'm wrong. So, what pushed me to write this book? Getting to prestigious schools of architecture all over, you know, Europe and US, being from Morocco, I found always this thirst. There is a thirst. You go and you hear schools of thoughts that they have nothing to do with you, and you understand them. You get to understand what they are saying. You get with them into the discourse, but yet it's not serving you. It's serving to improve others' discourses. And this is why it is time for local architects. I'm not saying local here in a way to make it like nationalists or anything to do with that. It just, we're belonging to a different context, different region, different climate, different culture, and how can architects again promote, regenerate that sense of cultural essence and what they call here the kernel, the content of the container. So the book actually was actually the result, first, for being a technical reviewer for the Aga Khan Award, and they had the chance to visit so many countries, so many projects, and evaluating these projects. So I learned much from that, and of course presenting the jury members in Geneva, debating with some very talented jury members, and that actually sharpened my views on a lot of issues, especially what are the trends. But in the same time, when I lived in the Gulf, especially in the UAE, I'm not here criticizing, please, UAE, and whatever I say here, I say it in a very academic setting. So it doesn't mean a negative criticism or something against someone, but just to situate it intellectually certain arguments for to construct a new discourse. So this stay in the UAE pushed me to think what the role of architecture, especially when you see extremes, skyscrapers done, some not all of them, I should not generalize, some of them they are just done for the show. So extremely exhibitionist architecture, and when you see where should be the human being or what kind of experience would be prompted, there is not much. Of course, they are working now a lot of bringing the sense of community, the sense of place, even in Dubai and Doha, but still is the extreme. So therefore, the title of this lecture is Architecture in a Critical Context, especially the Middle East. I'm sorry to use this term, is a contemporary term, Middle East, but I will explain to you it's just like a geographical limitation for the scope of my research, nothing ideological or political. So let me start by this slide. Look, this is like two cityscapes. One in the front, which is real estate that imitates the past, and on the back you have Burj Khalifa. And imagine with me this transition from one human scale to another one which is beyond the human scale. This is not what is actually alarming. What is alarming, like this beautiful drawing by Sid Mead, which is an art critic in New York Times, and he was imagining how Doha would be in 2030, in the future. And what you see here, now human beings, extraterrestrial ships, and then of course towers, and then you have the utopia, and with utopia there is euphoria. So how can this, we lose any mental construct with your past? And please, my presentation, I need just to underline, my presentation is not about advocating the past as a mere past and to be frozen in it, nor a futuristic, crazy, fictional drama of the future. So I'm situating my discourse in between learning from the past as a portfolio, encyclopedia of human experiences with S, and that past which actually dictates a certain prophecy, and hence the role of architects is primordial, because they are pulling the creativity side to embrace the future while they anchor that creativity on the ground by understanding the antecedents in a very deep way. So this kind of extreme scenes, they are alarming for us. They may be the future. Maybe the future would be just like that. But we're just saying, how can we be sustainable and actually include some of the human aspects, including the term culture that was misunderstood. I'm saying, I went to all schools of architecture, theory and criticism. This word culture was the victim of an ideology of 19th century till we reach the point that we even avoid to use it, all right, which is a problem. And hence, if now we are taking out this term culture, you know, radically, this is kind of the project we'll get. And there is an urgent need for a new orientation to cultivate responsible design practice, all right, geared towards a more responsive architecture. This model, you could see here, Croissant, this architect, the genius, and hence culture is hijacked, like in an orientalist way, and the whole building will be the symbol of Islam, which is totally wrong. Neither the green color nor the crescent is actually the symbols. There is no authentic text that are showing us that green is the color of the of Islam, nor the crescent. I mean, in French we say croissant, but this is actually what you can get as buildings, and hence we are in a very dramatic kind of iconic architecture, actually. However, I should not just mention some of the extremes that are actually leading architecture to get out of its context, but I should of course thank X architects to one local Emirati who has actually his practice in Dubai, and he's doing Mohammed Ali, and he's doing actually a fantastic job in terms of understanding not the local vocabulary of arches and domes, and this is a problem. This pseudo architecture of the traditional era, and we're falling into an architecture of pastiche. No, is how to explore the potential of a landscape. And please, landscape is not the landscaper in the classical way, sitting in a couple of gardens. No, we're talking about many layers of the landscape. And I prefer to use the word territory. Territory, the human aspect, the economic aspect, the ecological aspect, the environmental aspect, you know, the economic aspect. And how can the architects be more enlightened and more equipped, you know, with several tools to understand that locality and it's needed. There is another project, which is Souq Waqif. We may criticize Souq Waqif as a fabricated heritage, but I think we should also confess in the midst of those skyscrapers, there is no single public open space in Doha. And hence, this is the only open public space that was done by a local designer and artist. And I think this is the kind of experiences we need to have, regardless on how the form would be. And I will also underline in this regards that we architects will forget the human movement, the human motion, the human scale, the human aspiration, and we are so caught by the box and how that twisty box will be having a beautiful photograph for other architects to appreciate, but not maybe the user, like these guys riding that tricycle. Do you think he cares about your building? He cares about the energy he's pushing there to serve someone, to let him somewhere. So this is the kind of intriguing questions that comes to us between the reality of people and between an architecture that has nothing to do with its what milieu and, of course, environment. Therefore, I will ask here key questions. How to comprehend the background of architectural tradition in the Middle East and North Africa? And I know that I'm taking this region as a laboratory. You can expand that to Asia, to Bangladesh, and this is what I mentioned in my book. This is what I'm applying here. Anyone here who has that sincere concern to question this contemporary architecture that is becoming meaningless, to make it meaningful again. And this is not by the act of a pencil, please, or by a mustache being like Dali. This is needs to work like our master builders who worked with the community. So the second question, how to design architecture in the Middle East while observing contextual qualities without falling into emotional, what emotional pastiche? This is a problem. Whenever we want to get from the past, always we get to the formal part of it, but we don't bring the essence. We don't bring the meaning. And this is what I'll be exploring with you in this presentation. The third question is how to grasp a context in order to design a responsible way. And please, the word context may be demeaning, and they will pastiche that came after the era of austere abstract modernism. So therefore, culture was brought to architecture in a very abrupt way and gave us forms that are very heterogeneous, very eclectic, and non-having any sense of harmony. So therefore, the era of emotional regionalism, bringing it back to modernist abstract and empty meaning forms, and this is a problem of Europeans, North American, but not the problems of the other regions, but the problem of our regions that our architects, they already are very influenced by these discourses, but they never develop their own discourse. So therefore, the word context to make myself more neutral and talk about the potentials, not of site. Some people, they say cytology. You have a project and you have a plot and you need to understand the sun moving, you know, the simplistic way, and then where is north or west, and then you know what is the topography, and then you put your croquis. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about embracing the context with all its layers. I will come to that. How to explore contextual elements be it cultural, social, anthropological, environmental, etc., how to explore them in a very innovative way. It needs innovation. Hence, design cannot be detached from research and innovation, and they will deal with that. What are the different contextual and cultural meanings, not forms? Because in the past, every form had a raison d'être and had a meaning. So how can we explore the meanings and try to use them for a future project? How to reach a local anchorage without discarding the positive global input? Please, I'm not here advocating localism as something that we get frozen without getting international aspirations, but just for your information, I give you an example of the Aga Khan Award, the Aga Khan Award of Architecture. Some projects, they are done by some very simple people in simple places, but they innovated amazing innovative solutions. That would make a project universal. Doesn't mean rich mega project will gain the award. The award could be actually earned by a project that proves itself as what multi-layered and deciphering a certain complexity and adding a question to the practice and theory of architecture. Therefore, we are not against globalism. We are with the global positive part. However, we should be very careful not to erase our local identities with S. So I will start first by this background on the architecture of the Middle East, and I will show you what I mean by that. And please, the same thing should be done for your region. This second thing, some elements of vocabulary. And I will also try for the young architects here in the room, please, 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 when you copy a form and you stick it to a facade, be sure that you're not copying its constructive smart system. You're not copying how it was used by the humans in that time. You're not copying the symbolism that is not symbol. Don't think a symbol will come and be done in a drawing. A symbol needs years to be established as a meaningful message that the whole community agreed that form is sacred, holy, or whatever. This third thing, cultural and contextual meaning, which is this is the very important part for young architects, how to explore those meanings and try to reinterpret the meaning, maybe not with the previous form. You can bring your own form. And hence, I would also convey the message that architecture and competent architects, they are not just mimicking the past, but they can generate new forms, that they can generate new culture. So culture is not just that of the past, but also that we practice in a space to make it an amazing grassroots experience that will generate in its own culture. The last thing, just some discourses, how many people they spoke about this context or regional or name it. But I explained to you that my purpose here is not to defend regionalism nor to defend Kenneth Frampton's critical regionalism, because for me, of course, I'm not comparing myself to Kenneth Frampton, but I'm saying critical regionalism is the solution of a problem that was generated by the same people who invented critical regionalism, because it was a remedy for modernism. So it's not my problem. I mean, my problem is I have a rich region like what you have here and how I can explore it in my architecture, and architecture here as a vehicle of transmission of knowledge and, of course, a lot of cultural practices. So I'm sorry, I'll be a little bit fast here. So this is the region of my study, the region of my study here. So what I have, of course, North Africa. We have Turkey, Iran, Levant, and of course the Gulf countries. And this is just as a field study for the purpose of the book, and this is actually the place or the territory that I'm acquainted with more, that I visited, I went, I lived, etc. So this is just the... But what is interesting here in this slide, I'm just showing you the amount of, you know, the mountains. Did you see the chains of mountains? And mountains in the north and always desert and Sahara in the south. And by the way, even if you hear that there is, you know, desertic land, and next to it there is a mountain, always think that there is actually a strategic location to culture a civilization based on the plateaus, like Bangladesh with the Himalaya. This is why you have such this beautiful green land, because you are actually down. And this is why the Middle East was actually one of the amazing places where you can see that link between, you know, the mountains and then plateaus, and then the more you go down to the south, the more the climate gets harsh, and in between this kind of climate where architecture was actually developed. So the second thing, this is the stereotype about the Gulf, or about the desertic architecture. This is the stereotype. What is there? Just a camel and a tent, which is absolutely wrong. And we should not fall into this orientalist simplistic format of looking at architecture. First of all, we need to define architecture. Now, with technology, we're talking about textile architecture, we're talking about light structure architecture, we're talking about space. And just for your information, the notion of space that invaded the modernist language and its influence came from the East. Le Corbusier, what is done in Istanbul, and what is done in the Kasbah of Algiers in Algeria, Van der Eyck and with his croquis moving all around, the southern villages of the Mediterranean with their cubism, that those places that influenced modernists to come with an architecture of space. And therefore here, it's not about a physical boundary, it's not about a physical vehicle, but rather is about a human movement. And there is a wonderful book of Gustave Le Bon, La Civilisation des Arabes, or The Civilization of Arabs. What he said, these nomads, because they are moving all the time, they cannot build palaces. So what they do, their mobile house, which is that tent, which they carry with them. Why? Because they are always seeking sources of life. But on the other hand, what they developed, lots of human intangible qualities that they carry with them. So I will not dwell on that. Just the portfolio, some of the antecedents. Here I mentioned resilience. Look at this wonderful example from Yemen. This is a village of Hajara. And by the way, Hajara village, which is 12th century and is located on the top of a mountain at the altitude of 2,300 meters, you know, high. And look how they built in a very harsh physical locality, but how they generated their built environment in a very innovative way. Nowadays, if you don't have a flat land, you start, you know, especially us architects, oh my goodness, what I'll do with it? The cost is very high. Okay, dig in, a problem. So what about these people? You know, building a whole village at 2,300 meters. And it's called the Hajara. This is, for me, resilient architecture that stems out of the ground of a site in order to create a sustainable life, yet in a harsh environment, and they survive. The next one, this some of the Kazi will agree with me, how history, theory, and criticism always starts with Vitruvius. It's just like nothing was before. This is a problem. I mean, even in the schools of architecture, I've been leading schools of architecture for years now, I always want to question, where are the Assyrians? Where are the Canaanians? Where are the other civilizations before the classical era? Everything, the zero things start with Vitruvius. Impossible.
or start with the Romans and Greeks. And there is also a lot of scholarship now in North America questioning that and how themselves they copied from Egyptians, Canaanians, and Syrians, and no one speaks about that. And they think this is why, how to revisit the portfolio of those forms. Not, of course, to copy them verbatim, but at least to understand, like in your place here, India, you know, Bangladesh, and from the memory of my childhood, trust me, I was always hearing that place is just like the source of wisdom, you know, the your region here, and China. So we cannot just deny the ancestral knowledge of making settlements, and then sadly, in less than 40 years of modernism or whatever, there is nothing now, forget about it. We don't know what we're going to. At a certain time they were talking about deconstructivism, or I don't know, but now I don't know what they are talking about. So, and therefore, how can to actually have the, and I will summarize it here by saying empirical knowledge in working on an architecture of sense. And now, from this portfolio of classical empirical, you know, knowledge of architecture that exists in our region, we're moving now to another issue. All our countries, they were colonized, and we face a major problem of duality. And some of us, they became colonialists more than the colonial, and you know that. I don't want to hear to refer to literature of Franz Fanon, who said the rich of the earth, that means the ones who are copying the other worse than the ones who are actually coming from outside. And this is a whole problem of existentialist problem that I cannot solve in this lecture. But there was a serious issue of decolonizing architecture for building new states and modern states. And therefore here, like for instance, this attempt in Tehran, it was actually about setting up a symbol of Persia. I don't mind that, but I think this is also showing the issue of how to bring back your culture, but not through just one symbol or monument. But next to it, there is also some kind of pastiche. This is kind of a new town in Morocco and trying to imitate the Medina. And what we get, trust me, it's not working. This is just a formal mimicking of a Medina. So how can we bring that past? Of course, as you have in Dakka, I've been here for 3 days. Dakka is an amazing, vibrant city, but it has also major problems. Among the problems, housing. How to dwell this large number of immigrants coming from the rural areas, etc. And we end up by having this quantitative solution for housing, and hence architecture will become mere boxes and inhuman in some sense. Okay? And then the other issues, yes, before I end here, one of the issues that we should not forget, I did not put it here, especially in the Middle East context, what to do now with the reconstruction of Syria? What to do now with the reconstruction of Iraq? What the role of architects? You know how much concrete will be used to reconstruct, you know, demolished Aleppo or demolished part of Damascus or Libya. So there is actually a big, large construction sites. And are we prepared architecturally or maybe on the planning sense to project which future would be for the cities of these countries that they were damaged? There is no answer for that. And therefore, this is why the title I put, critical context, not just a context that can inspire us, but a context also that hurts us, that makes us suffer. So in between these two kind of extremes, what should be done? Now, let me be more architects. The first one was more just revisiting some of the philosophical, intellectual, conceptual terms that I need to straighten them with you, especially young architects, okay? The second, this question of mimicking antecedents, this question of mimicking or not even ornaments. I will explain the difference between ornament. But first of all, let me go back to what ignites my interest to write this book, this caricature. This is like just metaphor for the Gulf countries. And this is all the famous buildings, you know, Burj Khalifa. You see, you know this one in Abu Dhabi, and you have the twisted one in Dubai Marina. I know them all because I live there. I said these buildings, they look like bottles of perfume. Yeah? Do they have any sense with this guy here questioning where I am? Doesn't mean the Gulf, please don't get me wrong. I gave a presentation on Doha. They do have amazing ancestral settlements. They had a tradition, but because of that oil economy, and they did it, and trust me, they regret every day, though, or despite the fact that, of course, this new technology of building brought to them certain comforts because their climate is very harsh. Like when one of my students, Imarati, told her, you know, why are you doing that, sir? He said, do you want us to go back to the tent and be in a very harsh, hot climate? I said, no, you're right. Yeah, in a high-rise building, air-conditioned, which is fine. But however, what kind of future this kind of fragmented individual buildings, they don't create an urban structure. And if you see the evolution of Dubai, you know the famous photo from 1960 to now, there was just this Sheikh Zayed Road and then some individual buildings. And after they realize, there is no urban structure. So please, not fancy signed buildings of star architects, they will make a city. This is what the message I want to convey here. So what kind of urban setting we are envisaging to create the sense of community for architecture to come as a means to gather, not to segregate. And this is a very important thing. So now, this is the scope of the architect. I'm sorry, maybe I'm wrong, all right? But I am here. This is what is scholarship, is about making arguments and defending them. So the architect now, I've been in France, I was in England, in the US, and most of schools of architecture or, you know, practices, the architect is very busy with sun orientation. He want to see where is the west and east. And suddenly they make a beautiful drawing with that sun moving like that. You know that thing, yeah? Huh? And then the project is here. And then extending the scope of the site, you will make these visuals, like so seeing from here, seeing from there. And the worst thing, sometimes those lines of just seeing, they will become the concept, and they make a dot and center. And surface or the topography, just a surface. Because if he doesn't have a high rise that needs a lot of engineering, it's simple. 3 meters, 4 meters, put your foundations, you know, put like kind of entablature, and you're done. However, we architects, do we question? Doesn't mean what I'm saying here, you'll do it in every single project, but at least are you conscious about the other aspect that will grow with your practice if you're young? And I don't think an architect of 5 years will become the architect. Let's be modest. I think architecture beyond studying in school is a whole discipline, is a whole being to understand the depth of what people need, not what your ego wants to be. So this is a very important thing to understand: the social communal layer, the cultural layer, the physical layer that we are so busy with the physical, and then the biological layer, because everyone is talking about this buzzword sustainability. Excuse me, I just want to halt to explain that sustainability. Sustainability is not our solution. Solution when the cities, they were destroyed, when pollution of industrialized cities, they started being a phenomenon globally and they prompted climate change. So climate change prompted by the big mega cities industrialized. Who are the victims? Are the South. And hence, sustainability as a package to fix a problem that is not us. And everyone here is talking about sustainability. But I do agree if we use sustainability in an empirical way. Our ancestors, like that village in the top of that mountain, that was sustainable for me based on resilience. So we cannot apply sustainability unless there is resilience. What is resilience? Is boosting the immune system of a place to endure tough changes and get resolutions on the time or through time. And this is what makes sustainability sound. Smartness for me, it's just the play for gadgets. You know, gadgets, Wi-Fi. And now I really get mad when someone talk about smart and they think we were stupid in the past. And now just in 2018, we are smart. What happening here? So therefore, I think the environmental layer, if for instance, resilience is resolved to reach grassroots sustainability, and smart to boost the two and create a livable ecosystem, that what for me is the ideal situation. And architects, they play a major role in that. So these are some of the examples of that resilience. This is Algeria, this beautiful town in the south. And you look here, the oasis, you know, the palm, they call it palmery. And look how dense. And please, we were so into foreigners coming to see us, and whatever they say is true. And then we believed what they say. They say, this is disorder, this is a maze, it has no sense, there is no community, and they have a whole paper, if you want to read it, on that, called Planning Paradigm in the Medina, Order in Randomness. And they've proven by evidence that in that randomness, there is a high sense of order. Because there is a social order that exists in this very architecture that responds to its climate. Why? It's compact and dense. Because it's hot, you need more shade. Second, for security purpose. Because, you know, cities in the past, they were attacked. Third, to create more, what? More thermal comfort. Because all your facades of the house, they are protected. And the changes of climate, they don't touch the house. Local materials, etc. So this is just some of the examples to say. To come now to the contemporary, for not my lecture to be about historical, and this is what I try to prove to you, though I came from this conservation that I lived for a long time, because I was saying, do I need to be busy myself fixing the historical fragments, or do I need to look at this future, the future of this new generation and their aspirations on the future? So I've chosen, since I've understood, you know, modestly, the past, let me move now to push this portfolio of the past forward the future. And this is one of the good examples, for not to be just negative. I should say also some positive elements. This is be in the Islamic Art Museum, though of course the functional program of the building is a museum. However, if you look architecturally, and you are all architects and of course others in the room, no one can debate about the beauty of this building. And you know what? Because that architect was very modest. He went to Egypt. He surveyed the Fatimid's monuments. At least he's done an effort from the aesthetic level. But he did not fall into pastiche. And this is quite a very creative building that I visited. I advise anyone who did not see it from the inside. It's just beautiful how the inside and outside plays very well. So the next, actually, I have this caricature. I mentioned it before, but just to epitomize what I said in a very quintessential way, this is quite a critical example for me. I think, I'd like to thank an artist that, of course, we're working together in Safk and Sus in translating a lot of ideas in terms of, you see the discrepancy between a conservative couple and, you know, the German whatever engineer, architects, designing something I don't know for whom. And trust me, like now your apartments in Morocco or in any other places, you know, the building is done, the owner will get to the building And within the house, you start demolishing a wall, demolishing, because you are seven members in a family, and the guy designed it for a Westerner with a salon and stuff, and you have, you know, how to deal with that, so you start transforming your spaces. So therefore, this contrast between the users and the design of the buildings. The other thing now, this is the problem of scale and proportion, and of course the previous problem is the problem of function and space. And before I move, I have very, very, very key concept that I borrowed from Chomsky. He's a linguist. And he's using an expression that I admire. He was talking about the configurational, the strategic configurational pattern of language. That means every language has its strategy of configuration. So I used in that function and space this strategic configuration of space. That doesn't mean just four walls. You're sitting, sir, a line, and you're making a wall, and you're making a reception area. That and that's it. No. And this is why we need to distinguish between space and function. Function is a function, is a destination that has a name. Space is a void, and void that would embrace that function. So we should not be functionalists to have programmatic scenario for an architecture, nor space for the sake of space. When you look at MIS and you say, oh, beautiful spaces, but you showed me only a museum. Show me a space in the Middle East. Show me a space in Bangladesh. And when you go to your not traditional vernacular architecture, and you see how your spaces are very multifunctional, it's not like one space, one function. You see, therefore, the meaning of the space is not dictated by one function, but rather is dictated by the interpretation of that space in that very moment, and which purpose in every time of the day. If it's hot, if it's cold, they go up, they go down. So, excuse me, who frozen that architecture to be a spectacle, theatrical play of beautiful spaces with a glass to look through it? This is, I'm sorry, I'm getting here a little bit emotional, but you know, it's, you know what I'm saying here. So this problem of scale, so an existing scale here, and then sadly, you have this is the theatrical side of the city. Maybe this is the future. Maybe, yes, we should not actually, this is why, don't get me wrong, sometimes I say, please, maybe Dubai is the heaven of architects. You know why? Maybe in Dubai, we dare do architecture that we cannot do anywhere in the planet. Because in our places, don't forget, we are constrained. There are regulations, not to blame also architects. Regulations, real estaters, they became so powerful that the architects now are just following, you know. It's not like, you know, places where you can have a design that is designed from A to Z and you dictate it, etc. So, but however, how to resolve this question of scale, like Dhaka? I am a foreigner. I came, I was so dazzled by so many levels. There is an issue of cityscape. How it would be resolved, I don't know. So we are in a modern fabric, yes, but however, we are in a Bangladeshi vernacular architecture, though it is a global city, you see, because it is there shown. So therefore, how to deal with this question of scale, the scale of the city that dictates also the scale of the buildings. And how to work on that. The other elements that rarely would talk about it, and it was one of the powerful points of our architecture locally, how we played with light. Look at these beautiful small houses if you go to the countryside, and you see how light was a primordial element to create a space. Some spaces, they are defined only by light. And of course, the form that is sometimes, and I have here two examples. This is a dome of a contemporary theater in Marrakesh, and this is actually in the new university in Saudi Arabia, and it's also the very very good example, the campus university, donc in light used in a metaphorical way. And just regarding light, I'm using always light in four kind of typologies. Light as function, light as structure, light as metaphor, and sometimes light as symbolism. And you have no idea, talented architects, what they can do with light. And sometimes, just because you have a very bulky, heavy structure, just with a simple play of light, you can even reduce, you know, this thickness of the walls. The order and geometry. Now, when you try to apply in a certain design, let's say facade or volumes, we have a problem here between always how we design the box and how we want to beautify the box. And most of us architects, we fall into doing this cosmetic treatment, and we lost the sense of generative patterns. What is generative patterns? Doesn't mean monotonous order of forms. They are just for the sake of symmetry, but they are rather units of measurements that they anchor a composition through an order but not dictated, through a geometry that has nothing to do with symmetry or centrality. This is actually a beautiful fountain in the Madrasa al-Bu'naniya in Fez. And look how this is, of course, is a madrasa and praying hall. And look this person's doing their ablution, you know. And what you see here, you see the circle of the fountain, but you see the human body. What you see a different action. So there is the dictated form, but the user would make that form, what? That form to be embraced. So the link between these two dimensions creates an amazing order. Of course, this is Le Louvre. This is a sketch of the new museum of Jean Nouvel. I mean, I visited Le Louvre. I think I could not actually criticize. There are some masterpieces. We should confess and you say they are masterpieces. I visited that with my students when it was under construction, and then I visited lately when I saw it completed. But trust me, it is an amazing speculation of architecture. I'm not saying it's perfect or ideal, but I'm saying how to explore some local vocabularies in a contemporary way. But I'm not saying modernistic, because modernism is over now. So this is also a dome. And this is what is intriguing in Le Louvre regarding this concept of order and geometry. How the dome that was belonging to one of these buildings, normally this dome, normally should be on the top of one of these buildings, be it a mosque or... The dome will become monumental to cover part of the Medina. And therefore, this dialogue between the fabric and an architectural form, and there is no issue with that. So, quick, ornament and symbolism, and we have here actually the Marrakesh train station, which is on the done by local architects, and we have here, of course, Abu Dhabi building, which is a very famous building, and you could see that even digital design, I will come to talk about this new trend of digital design, which is problematic, honestly, and all of you agree with me. For sure, augmented reality, virtual reality, will bring to us a lot of means to facilitate how the project would be. BIM is an amazing tool to correct the errors at the conception level when you push the project to the execution. But however, are we equipped mentally as architects to go through the mental process of humans to generate a space for humans before you push the machine to create a space that has nothing to do with you and me? And this is actually a question that is open. However, I think a lot of these ornaments that they are coming out of the computer. I cannot criticize them. Some of them, they are fantastic, but it just what limits and how they would be explored. And you could see a lot of buildings now, they are, I remember when I was in the US, I don't want to mention names, there are some researchers working on digital design and they are getting crazy, really. And then, you know, they, and the problem, they take them from the computer, they implement them. And you have a heck of specifications of concrete and stuff. And at the end, they are not for human use, you know. But I need, before that, just please to explain. This is students of architecture, they don't make a distinction between an ornament and decor, decoration. An ornament is when the structural system, okay, is so ingenious, so creative, and creates some aesthetic forms in its own body. And the ornament is something that stems out of the body of the building as a grassroots form. Decor, when you finish and you come and you make decoration. So therefore, I prefer ornaments, but not ornaments that they become decor, you know? Because a lot of ornaments, they were very simplified, and then we just duplicate them. So therefore, the other issue that I mentioned at the start of vocabulary, I give you just an example. Foreign architects, okay? I don't know anything about Mughal architecture because I taught, you know, history of architecture. I was so pleased to use a lot of slides of your buildings here, but I've never been in them. You have no idea how happy I am this morning going to weekends or your House of Parliament. It was so inspiring, indeed. So here, what you see, this is a Yemeni facade, and this is a Tunisian facade, all right? They are both belonging to the same region, but doesn't mean regionalism or a region is one thing. We are so diverse. If like when I come and they tell you, where are you from? From Bangladesh. Oh, Bangladesh is like the same like India. Or sometimes you don't distinguish between Japanese and Chinese. I mean, we were born with some differences, and that's what makes us what rich. We're so diverse to have that exchange. But what the problem of architects, you know, he will bring you this element and he will combine it with this one. Because we know he doesn't know that this is coming from Yemen and the other one coming from Tunis. And the vocabulary of a facade in Tunis was actually done, okay, by Tunisians for centuries. Doesn't mean they didn't have foreign elements, you know? Let me explain this. In any creative society throughout history, there were always foreign elements, okay? Forget it, there is no homogeneous thing, all right? But what they do at the start, they adapted the form, all right? At the beginning, we start like something eclectic that get out of the fabric. But after it will get adopted, and that adoption that will make it part of your own fabric. And this is how cultural elements they were developed. The last thing I was also to mention, there is a major problem here with arches. I don't think that you don't have this problem. It is everywhere. I mean, Mughal arch is Mughal arch, you know? Andalusian Moorish art is Moorish art. So what our colleagues architects are doing? Look at this. These are the original, look, with measurements. And you know, the arch is very majestic. You know, you have third subdivision, fourth subdivision, fifth subdivision, and seventh subdivision. In Arabic, we say al-qisma. And they are so, the Moorish one is pointed, okay? And it has a shoulder, okay? So they are based on the system of construction that the craftsmen design the arch. If they take the system of construction, then they get an original arch. Our colleagues architects now, they have concrete. What they do it like that, sometimes like that, and you feel all kind of awkward arches all over. And look here, some for instance, just an example, this one will become this, this one, This one, because if you have an arch like that, you need the distance to make it more what powerful, majestic, and they cut it down like someone that you cut his legs. So, and then all kind of awkward stuff. Please, I am also talking to students of architecture. If you are looking to use in the future any vocabularies, try to build your book or sketchbook. I am so amazed how the architects, even in the protectorate period in Morocco, the French architects like Henri Prost, Labrade, we should not just criticize them. These guys, they studied our local architecture more than we do. Look at schools of architecture. Is anyone there teaching a course on Bengali architecture and with typological studies beside the art historian thing, descriptive? No. I mean, or sometimes even the one who is teaching that course is cursed. Oh, this guy of the past, just get a grade and get out. And then we get to the design studio. Let's do the project. Okay, the concept. And again, civil engineering, sweating to fix your concept. Okay? That's a problem. So let me end here. This is some elements of the context that I am suggesting. You know, this is a whole research that took me 6 years just for information. So what are these elements? I think we should to consider them in projects, but I'm not saying in an exhaustive way, every single project you'll do that. But just like a conscious state that we need to know that there is function and space, there is massing and volumetric composition, site typologies, we have patterns and textures, and what you decide doesn't mean you should use them, just not to get me wrong. And then we get to the whole discussion of Semper, ornament is a crime. Excuse me, Semper had his own problems, is his problem, not my problem. Okay, he said it in his own context. And here, oh, Semper said it, don't use any patterns. What this? And then you have all these poor guys in these neighborhoods. They build a mosque and they put this minaret in a box like wood. Did you see that? And you go to them and say, you know, you don't need to put it. Mosque doesn't need a minaret. No, sir. No, it's a mosque. So change it in his mind. So therefore, this question of ornaments or motifs, it's not something just to blame. Ornaments, of course, if there are any, order and geometry, light and form, and each category, of course, like for instance, this massing is very important. There is this issue of now capacity, the skyline, the connectedness, the transition, fragmentation. If you took the function and space, we have this space and functions versus place. It's very important. Space and function, they may not create a place. Okay? You have this program, you have the function, you put it in a space, but doesn't mean you are creating a place. Place is more, is deeper than just having an ephemeral place. Anyway, I don't want to explain that too much because I need to, I'm sorry, I'm getting fast, just to show you some of the meanings. I think I wish that you two and my dear colleagues, researchers, professors in the room, they can explore this beautiful territory of Bangladesh and what we can deduce, and they would love to see not the forms, I'd like to see the meanings of the forms of your context here. So just a couple of examples. So this questions of getting rid of the physical form and trying to understand, like where this is in Iran, it's called Bojordi House. It's in Kashan. When I was in Kashan, I was so overwhelmed by how they mastered the construction with bricks. You feel under a dome in a house in Kashan. Just that master builder, like Kazi said, he was playing. He had an orchestra. He was playing music. You know how he shifted that bricks, how he moved different levels, and I've seen some spectacular domes. Knowing that, the dome was the most difficult technical form to achieve. Yet, out of the constraint, they opened the vista of opportunities, and they produced a vast array of typologies of domes in a spectacular way. But the dome was not just nowadays, you make a dome just for the show. Dome was for a reason. Sometimes to have larger spaces, dome was also for heat as well, for acoustics. There were a lot of reasons behind that. The other thing is this cultural value judgment and symbolic codes, cognitive schemata and transmission. I'm not talking now about like a simple, you know, fragment. No. What kind of meaning we get from each architectural form that will become a cultural practice, and that cultural practice will become a vocabulary. Let me simplify. If you come to Medina of Fez, a lot of dialect proverbs, they are derived from architecture. We have in Fez, we say, you are from the big house, like Dar Kbira. If you say to someone, you are from the big house. By the way, it doesn't mean big house that is big, that he has a house that is big. He may be just in a small house. But big house, that means a house that is generous, the house that is, the family is educated, polite. And we are using what? An architectural connotation to describe a social quality, which is your big coming from Dar al-Kibira. It might not sound for you, but for me it sounds, because I am from the context. Or sometimes they say, how many qubbas in your house? How many cupolas or domes? And the dome doesn't mean you have a dome. Qubba is just the room where you receive generously your guests. And the dome architecturally is a symbol of a structure, but socially it's a symbol of what? Of being generous. You are, I'm receiving you under the qubba. Even the qubba does not exist. Alright? So this kind of link between social meaning and architecture that embodies the spirit of a community, and this is where we get this sense of belonging. Now everyone is talking about sense of belonging. How you get a sense of belonging? In a mall? I was in a Ibn Battuta mall. Did you visit Ibn Battuta mall in Dubai? So go there and have a sense of belonging. Yeah, there is no sense of belonging in a mall. You need to be together in a space, not in your apartment and you close the door. Where are these intermediate corners when you were as kids and the whole street memory? Now the word street is becoming very negative. It's just like a street person, it means what? You know the meaning. So here, this is not again recalling heritage for the sake of it. I'm just explaining. Look at this staircase. Excuse me, do you think that this staircase will come from a 2D, from a plan? It can't. All the architects, the first step, give me the program, translate the program in a plan, and within the plan there is a rose, a flower. I don't know how it will, you know, get in elevation. But these guys, they were molding space. They were molding space. Because you know what? It's the movement, it's the experience, it's the human scale, it's the sight, it's inspiration, it's light, and a lot of constraints. You know, a lot of constraints. It's not like now we have that concrete and we can do whatever we want. So therefore, any architectural conception should embed certain messages to be transmitted. I'm not saying that the contemporary projects, some of them, they don't do that. I'm sorry. Talented architects who takes time to conceive, they really create amazing future experiences for their users. This is I have the slide. This is Ibn Battuta Mall in Dubai. Yeah, you can have India, you can have North Africa, you know, the Ibn Battuta, the traveler, and the traveler, they got to have wherever that traveler went, so they did pavilions, and then you can live in spectacle way in every whatever dynastic space. But again, is it actually authentic? It's question mark. But don't forget, this is used to attract more consumers and push your pocket to get more money, and culture becomes a commodity, and commodity, you know, it becomes exactly like this fast sandwich, all right? And here, a sense of community. And I use here representation, expression of cultural meaning. In your project, how can you, beyond any simple form, imagine, envisage what kind of cultural, social, or even users, whatever culture, I'm not saying here one religion or one culture with S, but you can there are, of course, some unique spaces that they are admired by all, Taj Mahal, you can, or the Alhambra. Everyone actually admires Alhambra. And that's what makes actually the work of architecture timeless. This was a very poor neighborhood in a town in the north of Morocco, Chefchaouen. And look, this is not a work of an architect, it's a work of these owners that they painted the whole neighborhood and each one decided to put flowers. You see that? Imagine that situation where the users are conceiving a new appearance, new experience for their own things. Can the architect prospect that intention? And that what is actually quite complex, but it's one day would be amazing if we train our students to get to that representation of a certain deep expression, etc. So this is actually just to make a spatial cultural arrangement. This is the because actually I visited this house with the Aga Khan Award. So look at this very complex structure. With air ventilation, there is a basin, and you know the catching of the air and how it moves. Very environmental. I'm not getting here emotional. And you know who designed this? Tell me who designed this. Don't worry, I'll mention the name. Whatever happened, huh? Thanks God, it was not implemented. It was not executed. Okay, this is designed by Libeskind. Yeah, indeed, I think in the UAE was proposed. When I saw the clip of Libeskind talking about this building, I was devastated. I finished, by the way, I'm getting to the end. Libeskind, please check the video, all right? I remember which WW, just say, Crescent Building, Libeskind, and he would say, while touching the sun, and while touching the sand, this moon, this crescent, for him is the symbol of Islam. Be careful. You see the problem of perception. And then he got us this spectacular building. But you know what? The catastrophe, civil engineering put that. I wish if I could not see this, because technology now, you can make it without this. Please go, pull up, just put in Google, Libeskind crescent building, and it will get to you. All right? I did not make it up. This is not caricature. This is his drawing. By the way, this is our drawing, but the building is with fancy AutoCAD, 3D Max, and maybe push to Maya, and there are birds, you know, everywhere. Okay, but look at this. All right? Okay, and the one who is living here next to this pillar, I don't know what he will see. There is no Arabia, no desert, no moon. Okay, some of the solutions, empirical ones, how can we explore them? Of course, there is actually a wonderful building that got the Aga Khan Award. I think you know this building, the ones they are involved with the Aga Khan. And this is actually a building that is amazing, using, I forgot the place of it, but it's in Asia. It's using a tropical climate solution used by the native houses. You know, in tropical climate, too much rain. So the roof will be very flat, and the window will get up for not the water get in. And they have, because you close everything for not to get protected from the rain, so they left holes underneath for the air to enter, because it happens to you when you close all windows, there is no air. So they created a very ingenious device. And this architect, for instance, this is a good example how to explore this local ancestral solution within a high-rise building. What is the problem? I think be it past or be it present or be in future, it's all about smart solution for a problem. All right? So why we architects are so busy copying Zaha Hadid, copying Libeskind, and copying others? Why? Yes, there is actually learning from other experiences. There is no problem about that. But when we are mimicking and we become the copy of the copy, and the copy of the copy copied by a copy. Okay? That's a problem. Okay, that's a problem. So I don't want to mention more. This is why I'm coming to this stand: morality, ethics, and responsibility. And please, any young architect students in the room, please, the discipline of architecture is now separating itself from the responsibility and the ethical side of the architect. Sometimes, if you disagree with a project, of course, you will not starve. Don't worry. No one will starve. Okay? You are a good architect if you put your, you push, and you are an architect of sense. People, they will recognize that and they will come. Of course, you'll be suffering for 10 years, but after you'll become an architect who imposes stuff. Not an architect that, you know, no ethics, no morals, you know, being a servant of a real estater, that is a problem. And of course, and you say, this responsibility towards the society, towards individuals, towards your own family, in terms of how, you know, to understand how architecture works, etc. So, trends and discourses, very quick. That doesn't mean I'm the only one who is actually pushing to understand the genius Lotchi, as Norman Shoes actually put it, but actually there are different attempts. Please, I'm alarming you. I'm not showing these examples like I am believing in them, all right? This is an academic work, when this is just for the sake of showing what attempts, how architects in this region, not nowadays, not even long before, they try to understand this contextualism. But I alarm you, some of them, they are very fictional. Some of them, they are very emotional. Some of them, they are mimicking forms. But let's just understand them, right? So this is Rasim Badran, and you know Rasim Badran in Jordan. Rasim Badran, the quality of Rasim Badran, he was an amazing, first before being an architectural artist, and since he studied in German schools, he was having that technicalities and engineering mind with, of course, the capturing forms through his artistic talent. So he combined between this technicality and engineering sense with, of course, the artistic talent without falling into emotionalists, you know, artistic thing just for whimsical ends. And he tried. This is, before I move, actually, you have Rasim Badran, Rifat al-Jadarji, who was in Iraq. We have Hassan Fathi. All of you, you know Hassan Fathi. I have actually an example of Hassan Fathi. So there were some attempts to capture the essence of this context within architecture. So the second thing, actually, now, this regionalism and internationalism, I don't want to dwell on that because I discussed what is regionalism before. Please be careful with this word. I'm not a regionalist, okay? Nor I'm advocating regionalism. I am just myself. I want to put a jacket with a measure of my body, period. And I feel the rain will not get to my skin. Fine, okay? Don't call me regionalist, don't call me modernist, don't call me postmodernist, don't call me traditionalist. Use those terms and leave them for you, okay? Because these are all connotations to simplify the language of architecture, though I'm getting extreme here, Kazi, I know. Because we share so much with Kazi. So this, also this paradoxical design, what to do? This is a market, a mall in Dubai. There are attempts, of course, to mimic the Musharabiya, and what to do this. Of course, adjective Arabic or adjective Islamic is another discussion. I don't want to get to that. Doesn't mean I am not with an architecture that was made in Muslim societies and Muslim rule, but we need to be very careful again by the adjective Islamic to simplify it to series of domes, like the airport of Sharjah. You should see the airport of Sharjah. Please just put Google. The first time, you know, I came to the Sharjah, when I looked at that building, I said, this is congregational mosque. Wallahi, I swear. I thought it's a congregational mosque. And it ended up being an airport. You know, why? Because there is this giant dome. And they have these towers for watching planes. They do them like minarets. And it just, for me, devastating. This for, we need to be very careful with the Islamic, for not all the buildings, they look like mosques. However, within the realm of this architecture of Muslim societies, you have Medinas, they don't have a single arch. I don't know from where they got the arch. Arch was has a reason that. So therefore, you have this is a reinvention of tradition, and they think some of the architects they were very talented. And here we have actually, I think this is the project of Salih Makia, if I'm not. This is no Mohammed Makia, the Grand Mosque of Kuwait that was built in 1984, and Makia in somehow he's close to Rasim Badran. He is also believing that the ornament, as I said before, should stem out of the structural body. And you could see it here, very rigid, though the dome, and of course this part is quite ruining the conception, of course, especially this frieze here. But however, what you see here, there is a certain kind of conceptualizing the some of the local vocabularies and capturing them within the concrete structural system. The other thing now, Hassan Fathi, of course, I have an article with Hassan Fathi about the market of Kharga, and I think Hassan Fathi was misunderstood a lot. Was misunderstood by his people. Yeah, remember the Kharga village. Not Kharga, the other one. Khurga, what's his name? I forgot. The first village he designed, the peasants did not want to live in the village, okay? However, Hassan Fathi was actually cultivating a sense of how to create an architecture for the people. The translation of his book into Arabic, the title is awkward. It's not the architecture of the poor. He said in French, by the way, he wrote his book in French, construire avec le peuple. Build with people. Look at the English version. Architecture of the poor. See, lost in translation. So what Hassan Fathi was about, I think, when you read his memoirs and things, was just like looking at an ancestral building know-how. He was not advocating the arch or the dome. Absolutely not. Because if you use earthen architecture, it dictates certain form if you don't use concrete at all. So therefore, it was a technicist kind of approach using a local know-how to face the monopoly of the concrete companies in Egypt. And this is why he was combated. He was actually not left alone. However, what is also important in Hassan Fathi, especially in his book when he describes Al-Fallahin, rural area, and we should here underline the importance or the voice of Hassan Fathi, thinking not urban. And they will just underline this, we need actually to work on this dichotomy of urban-rural. There is no urban, no rural. There is always a territory that needs to be designed or planned for the well-being of people. And they think Hassan Fathi did well in that sense. Okay, this is the post-Orientalists. We're doing worse than Orientalists. Okay, I get so mad when I get to a hotel, like for instance in Marrakesh. You know, we are criticizing the Orientalists because they are diminishing the image of our culture, and you find an owner of a hotel putting that sheikh with a pipe. So this is a Moroccan owner or a Bangladeshi owner taking a painting of an Orientalist, and he is not even hanging it, no, in his brain. Okay, and that's a problem. And here you have this kind of, I don't know how to call this. This is like Alibaba thing, something. You know, I mean, to be honest, just the architects who thought like that, just to get us this form. Maybe in Mars, don't get me wrong, because they discovered Mars now. They said maybe they will may discover something. We can have some, if technologically proven, this form, maybe it's sustainable. No problem. But just to come, because you are alone in your table, and you want to dictate the rule, and you want me to live on the peak of that building, it's a problem, you know? This is a problem. Okay, don't worry. There is a piece of land here, landscape. This is the problem. Look, what the link between. This is anti-landscape and this is landscape. All right? And last thing, theme parks. I think this is another phenomenon in the Middle East. Lots of theme parks. Lots of theme parks. Alibaba theme park. Mada'in theme park. And the one theme, one subject will make it what? A park. And you know what, the theme park, so these mega projects that they dictate their rule within a gated territory, it's a, how actually, maybe they are in that climate, maybe they are fine. Why? Because there is no urban fabric. You cannot come to Dhaka and you demolish a whole district and set a theme park, impossible. Okay, so last elements. This is a beautiful project by three young architects in Morocco and won so many awards. Very simple forms, and actually projects that needs really lot of, it's a university campus in the south. And here, and this is the final slide. I know you're getting tired, okay? I've been very talkative, but for a reason. So, a design, I'm not saying that you should take this and, of course, apply it verbatim, but it just, for me, what is missing in terms of this reflective, that Kazi mentioned, the reflective process of the architect to reach that embedded meanings within a project in a locality that may reveal certain meaning, but not automatically a certain style or certain authentic frozen form. So, I don't have my glasses. All right, the first thing I think, what we start a project, we start always by terms of reference, okay? Terms tall, terms of reference. I think we get to do recommendations, orientations, and then of course, you know, practical actions from the concepts and from the ideas of the program. So we move to a master plan, and after master plan, there are some key guiding elements of design, and then of course, these guiding elements, they are not solutions, so therefore how to transform them to solutions, not for the poor engineer to get stuck with your fancy design. And then of course, there are some certain triggers that those triggers, what they do a kind of embedded solutions for problems, but going back to the terms to evaluate if you respected the terms or not. But within that spectrum, of course, there is a whole series of elements, the description of the project, SPP statement of the problem of the project, context inquiry and analysis. No one is doing this. No one is doing this. All right, how can we do this context? Like colleagues who traveled from a country to country because a customer wanted to do something that belongs somewhere else. And they wanted to understand, for instance, this is very important. So, and then, of course, the context inquiry and analysis. What is it? Of course, not always with all the elements I said, but with the minimum. And of course, here the authentication and benchmarking is not the only one that you are inventing. And sometimes we are reinventing the wheel. So what kind of solutions they are already there? And then we move to sustainability, contextual framework, what the meanings, what the elements that a project should respect, design qualifiers and values. This is very important, not just design as a form, but what design from your perspective as an architect can actually prompt as qualifiers and elements that can get to, could you help me with that? Yes, design scenarios, I think you experienced that. No project can get one single shot. It's always like a portrait, you know, always you need to sketch, and the more there are scenarios, the more are rooms to include some contextual meanings. And of course, design master integrative scenarios, when you get to get lost to so many variables, and then how to optimize and get to that discussion to make their feasibility. And they think few of us reach the feasibility strategy, and this feasibility strategy may be very critical, even in pushing maybe and changing an element here even, of course. And the executive technical plan, and you know what the hell it means with all the details, and it's a nightmare, of course, I know that. And implementation scheme, but what is important, like for instance, this is what I learned from the Aga Khan Award, being a technical reviewer, post-mortem evaluation. Don't do me that project as an architect, and then you disappear, okay? And you never go back, because you're, oh, I don't want to see it again. Don't do it, okay? Be what? Courageous to go to that building after 10 years. Do it just for yourself, like, you know, someone done a scene. I'm sorry, I'm just exaggerating. Just go and see, Because you will learn from your mistakes. Even Alberti, in his treatise, he has one chapter at the end of the treatise, defects of buildings. Architecture never in history was done like one shot, you leave it, oh, it's my legacy. But like they say, you know, the doctors and physicians, they bury their cadavers and their mistakes with their dead, but the architects, they expose them. They're always there. And they sometimes you get so ashamed. Is it me who's done that building? No, it's not me. Thank you so much. I just, you know, been a bit enthusiastic. This is a conclusion that you can read. Thank you. And with your questions, I can actually elaborate more. I know it's been late. And they have a plane, by the way, just after this lecture. I'm heading to the airport. But I still have time. Please, do you have questions?
We are going to take very few questions. Please keep it short and to the point.
Everything is understood. Happy I am. Yes. Especially students. Okay, how many students in the room? Could you raise your hands? Okay, good. I don't want to ask how many senior architects.
how do you define senior?
Senior, someone with more than 10 years of practice. Yes. Please. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. And please don't, just one little small conclusion. Whatever I said, it comes out of my, you know, some of the stuff that I'm questioning about my society, about our regions. We have amazing wealth, you know, of knowledge and know-how. And look what's happening. We cannot just stay and say, don't question the things. So nothing personal. All what I said, just true, straight messages, no agenda, no nothing. And thank you so much for bearing some of my criticism, but you have understood the context of my criticism. Thank you so much.
Thanks everybody for being here today. Please keep an eye on the announcement about upcoming academic sessions. And see you there. Thanks, Professor Radoine. Thank you.